Hi everyone, I'm Carl from Cedro Alto. We are still on the topic of transparency in the coffee supply chain, and today we're going to look at the different forms in which coffee can be sold, from green coffee that roasters are going to be receiving wherever they're located in the world, to fresh cherry sitting on the trees in a farm in a different part of the world. So taking an example that we've looked at before, we have a roaster price, FCA, which we saw in our last video, is the same as what we sometimes call FOT, free on truck, free carrier. So this is in the roaster's home country or region, coffee loaded onto a truck by an importer for delivery to that roaster. So let's say that roaster price, not including shipping, delivery to the roaster's door is $4 per pound. Then the exporter price, what the exporter charges to the importer. Now these could be exporter and importer companies, they could be producers exporting or importing. There's a variety of possibilities that we've looked at before. But let's say this FOB price, just because it's a clean, defined moment in the coffee supply chain, that this is $3 per pound. And then we have a farmer price of $2 per pound. But where this gets tricky is the movement from exporter to farmer. So an exporter is turning over FOB bags of prepared green coffee. The roaster is buying bags of prepared green coffee. However, a farmer in all likelihood is not handing over bags of prepared green coffee. This is a different product. Therefore, it's very difficult to say at the roaster level, this $4, how much of that $4 per pound of green coffee went to the farmer per pound of green coffee, because the farmer is not handing over pounds of green coffee. This would be like saying, what was this wheat farmer paid for this cake? Although a wheat farmer didn't make a cake. A wheat farmer didn't sell a cake. So how can we say what the wheat farmer was paid for the cake? Inevitably, the farmer price, unless they're exporting, importing, and shipping off in a truck to a roaster, is going to be a derivative number. So in the second video, we looked at farmer price. So if you're a roaster receiving transparency data from your supply chain, this includes a farmer price, you need to know for that price the farmer was paid, what did the farmer have to do? So that farmer price could be farm gate, it could be Ex Works mill, so this could be placed at the dry mill where it's received by the exporter. This could be already milled and selected, in which case the farmer is incurring the cost of milling. Or this could be FOB if the farmer is exporting. If we're talking about small farmers, then this is most likely going to be a farm gate price, which is derivative. So if the farm gate price is derivative of the milled and selected price, what percentage? What is the conversion of whatever form of coffee the farmer turned over to milled and selected green coffee? From the FOB price, how do we get to this? How do we derive the price that was paid to the farmer? Because if the farmer turned in something that was different from the product that's being exported, there needs to be a calculation to figure out an equivalency. So in order to know this derivative price of green coffee paid for a different product, we need to know what form of coffee was sold. So beginning with green coffee, just as a baseline, green coffee itself would be worth 100% of the green coffee price. In our case here in Colombia, dealing with small lots from small farms of specialty coffee, most likely this is going to be dry parchment. So a question if we're dealing with dry parchment is where? Where is this transaction taking place? Is this at the actual farm, at the nearest town to the farm, at a dry mill, potentially very far away? Who's responsible for the shipping cost as well as the yield? How much dry parchment coffee is needed to complete one bag of export grade green coffee? Just taking round numbers, about 70 to 80% of dry parchment will become clean green coffee. We also have dry cherry, if this is natural processed coffee, and this could be about 50%, because when the cherry is dried without having depulped, all that fruit pulp and cherry skin, it remains part of the product that's being sold, and that has a weight. So when we're milling a natural processed coffee, the weight loss is going to be much greater because of the cherry skins and dried fruit pulp that's connected when it begins the milling process. Honey processed parchment is also going to be heavier than a wash processed parchment because the fruit pulp that's not washed off of the depulped cherry remains connected to that parchment. So the yield factor is going to be higher, therefore the parchment green coffee yield is going to be lower. But in any case, the price that we're really looking at is for green coffee, so we can just subtract the weight of those other sub-products that aren't going to be used for much. Another form in which coffee is sold quite often by farmers here in Colombia, outside of the specialty grade and quite often in other parts of the world, is wet parchment. So in this case, coffee cherries are depulped, fermented, washed to take off the fermented fruit particles, but that coffee is not being dried, most likely because of cash flow issues or just because the farmer would prefer to be paid right away rather than having to wait at least a week, if not much more, to dry that and sell it as dry parchment. This also happens often when the weather doesn't cooperate, when it's rainy and cloudy, and it's much more difficult to dry coffee unless you have a mechanical dryer. The wet parchment to dry parchment yield is about 50%, and then if 70 to 80% of dry parchment yields green coffee, then we're going to have about 35 to 40% of wet parchment will become export grade green coffee. At least here in Colombia, wet parchment will very rarely, if ever, become high-end specialty coffee, just because of the delay between fermenting, washing, and then beginning the drying process. There's a high probability that microbiological activity will not be ideal when this wet parchment coffee is being stored, weighed, transported, etc. And then once it's sold, it's going to mechanical dryers, which in the vast majority of cases are running very hot to dry this coffee as fast as possible, which is not conducive to very good cup quality. Beyond wet parchment, there are several other forms in which coffee is sold that are less common here, and I don't know that much about them personally. One would be baba, which translate directly to like slobber, but this basically means coffee cherry that's depulped but not fermented and washed yet, so it still has the I guess technically what you call this mucilage, sticky fruit goo connected to the beans that would then be fermented in order to remove it. If this could also be wet hulled, which I understand is common in parts of Indonesia. Nobody does that here in Colombia, and I'm not exactly sure what the conversions would be, but other variables to keep in mind. And then on down the line, this could be picked cherry. So if a farmer is selling picked cherry, a typical conversion of nice round number would be 5 to 1. So 5 times dry parchment. So if 20% of the picked cherry is dry parchment and about 75% of dry parchment is green coffee, 15% of the weight of picked cherry constitutes green coffee. This number can vary, and when cherry is being sold, the calculation method can vary as well. How the value of the green coffee that is produced from picked cherry that's sold by a farmer can also vary quite widely. If this is a farmer-owned co-op or some kind of organization like that, perhaps the end value of this green coffee will be shared among the producers of the cherry. But if this is an independent processor buying cherry and then converting that into another product that they are going to be selling, this picked cherry is not necessarily going to be specialty grade. Sure, you can look at varietal altitude. You can use a Brix meter to look at the sugar content to kind of get an idea of what potential quality might be inside these cherries. But really, if someone else is processing these, someone else is handling fermentation and drying, then they're arguably responsible for the quality that may or may not come out of them. So in those cases, at least according to what I've seen often here in Colombia, that value would not be shared with producers of the picked cherry because they're not responsible for that value that's being added by some other actor in the supply chain. And then at the very other extreme here, we have live cherry. There are cases in which the farmer is only going to be maintaining the coffee fields and not doing any of the processing whatsoever, not even going to be picking. There are systems out there and not so far away where the exporter is handling the entire coffee processing and even sending their own crew of pickers to go into a farmer's coffee plot, take away the cherry, doing the processing, dry milling, exporting, everything on there. So at each step here, at each step down, there's work to do. So each step up that a farmer can take, more money they're going to be making and more work they're going to be doing. And if they're selling below the green coffee level, there's other work that someone else is doing and deserves to be compensated for. There's time involved, and in areas like here where the cost of capital is quite high, the time value of money then will be significant. So just having working capital deployed in product that you're not able to sell yet because you're still processing it is a significant line item in someone's cost structure. Some of these processes require skill, especially wet milling, monitoring and knowing how to ferment coffee and dry coffee in a way that will lead to a high quality finished product, as well as infrastructure. These are facilities that someone needs to purchase and maintain, especially the dry mill, which is needs to be quite large in order to be efficient and is quite costly. We're looking at transparency data, and we want to know what portion of 1 pound of green coffee went to farmers. This would be a way that one could derive these prices if one wanted to. And this would be the absolute amount of money that's arriving to that farmer. And in my opinion, that would be the correct way to express this, but it's not the only way. For example, if we're comparing one farmer that turned in green coffee with another farmer that turned in parchment coffee, the parchment price is going to be quite a lot less. And a big difference would be that the farmer turning in green coffee incurred the cost of dry milling. So in order to compare apples to apples, how would you express this? Would you express the amount of money that the farmer actually received? Or would you put in a hypothetical cost? So in order to compare one farmer turning in green coffee to another farmer turning in dry parchment coffee, include in that farmer price for dry parchment coffee the cost that would have been incurred by the farmer had they paid for dry milling, of wet milling, drying, dry milling, in order to convert that cherry into green coffee. So of course they're going to be earning less for it, but perhaps one way of making the numbers more comparable would be to include in that farmer price number what it would have cost that farmer to convert that cherry into green coffee. Since these numbers are all derivative anyway, because farmers in very few cases are going to be receiving US dollars per pound of export grade green coffee, there's no standardized way of expressing the farmer price based on a product that they did not sell. But once we go down that road of hypothetical costs that would have been incurred in order to compare one farmer price of one product to a different farmer price of a totally different product, this can get quite fictional and stray from the facts quite a bit. So the way I've always handled this, the way Cedrauta's transparency information is expressed is always with the amount of currency that's actually being handed over to producers, with context as to how we calculated that number in a way that the roaster market can interpret. So now that you know basically what these conversions look like when you're receiving transparency information from whoever's selling you green coffee, now you can know what questions to ask. In what form was this coffee handed over by a producer to a buyer, and whether this number is the actual amount of currency being handed to the farmer, or if this includes any hypothetical costs, or basically how all this is calculated. If we can figure out, studying our supply chains, for each pound of green coffee what income is the farmer earning, then that's one step in the right direction. According to the price of green coffee, how much should a farmer be earning for their contribution to a supply chain at these different phases? This is what we're going to look at in our next video, so stay tuned for that next week. If you're just finding out about Cedrarauto through these videos, you should probably know that as a farmers collective, our main objective is to sell the green coffees produced by our members to roasters in other parts of the world that appreciate these coffees and are willing to compensate farmers for their efforts. Right now, we have spot coffees in the US, the UK, Australia, and New Zealand. If you're interested in sourcing coffees through our collective group and partnering with one or more producers, feel free to reach out to me directly. My contact information is in the description of this video. Thanks as always for watching. If you found this information interesting and useful, please go ahead and subscribe to our channel. And if any additional questions come up or you have any ideas for new videos, anything you don't understand about the coffee supply chain or would like to dig into a little more, feel free to leave it in the comments and we'll try to address it in a future video. Thank you.